What's up, YouTube? Del here from Zephyr, and today I am bringing an update to Memento. Now, it's technically like Mementals, but referring to them as Memento is basically a little bit better. So these cards are, they look absolutely amazing because they're all bone creatures of some of the classic Yu-Gi-Oh! Monsters, which is why I really, really do like the look of the deck. It did get one brand new card in Phantom Nightmare, and this is a bit of a more aggressive style deck that I've put together. Previously I did use the Dolmatica package, but I feel that in this current format there are a lot of different variant decks such as Voiceless Voice that are using the Dolmatica package where they will actually benefit if you use Maximus. So I've adapted this deck to have a balance of going first and second while also giving you that ability to crack back or board break should you need to. So with all of that out of the way, please smash that like button, hit that notification bell and subscribe so you don't miss out on any more upcoming content. We're going to start off with the first monster of the day, and that is two of your big Mac Daddy boss monster, the Combined Creation. So this is your aggressive boss monster. Unfortunately, it cannot be normal summoned or set, and it must be special summoned from the hand or graveyard by shuffling five other Memento monsters with different names from your hand and or graveyard or deck back into the main deck or extra deck. Now, it does say extra deck, so I'm hoping in the future we get a Memento extra deck monster, which would be very, very cool. And the benefit of this one is because we've got a brand new one in the form of Gatik, I'm just going to call it Karibo. This will actually give you the benefit of being an additional name, which is something you were slightly lacking when you were trying to make this. Like, you could make it in general, but it's nice to have an additional name to help you do so. Then, of course, your best starters of the day are, of course, Darkblade and, of course, the Angle Witch. So the idea of these is your Darkblade will get you into your Witch. Either way, you are trying to get your starters to go through it. Now, all of these have the different effects to try and pop cards in the deck or destroy mementos in the deck, send them to the graveyard, you name it, and that's really what you're trying to do in order to go through everything you need to. You've then got three of the Tatsu. So this is obviously, the biggest issue with this one is you need to control. So if you do not control any other face-up monsters other than mementos, which is the biggest issue of it, you get to special summon it for free. So the fact is a level 5 does hinder you when you're trying to play the Dolmatica package if you're trying to play Super Poly, which is why I'd arguably want to cut this at 2. But the way I kind of look at it is as long as I get a memento on the board and then have the ability to special summon this down, from that point on, it really doesn't matter if I have additional cards on the board. So that's something that I'm trying out with an additional card in the main deck, and you'll see that when I get to it. We've then got two Mace, followed up by one of the Trihorn Dragon, one Goblin, and then one of the brand new Gatik. Now, the reason this one's so good is on normal or special, you get to target a memento card in your graveyard, accept itself, and add it to the hand. If it's sent to the graveyard by a memento monster's effect, you get to special summon this card. So it gives you an additional resource on the board that can then be later on destroyed by your other mementos to send them to the graveyard, destroy them, do what they need to. But on top of that, it also allows you to add one of the cards you will send to the graveyard off of the back of something like Goblin back to the hand, or recycle Mace, which becomes a bit of a snatch deal during your opponent's turn. So giving you the best of everything you need. We're then, of course, playing Triple Bone Party. Now, if you're looking to build this deck, try and grab this one as soon as you possibly can. This is probably, alongside the Angle Witch, the most expensive cards of the two decks. This one's had a little bit of hype going around it lately, so I've seen more people trying to pick this up. So that's just kind of giving you a bit of an observation on what I've been noticing. So the reason Bone Party is so good is you destroy a memento monster in your hand or face up on the field to take a memento monster from the deck with a different name and either add it to the hand or special summon it in defense. During your main phase, you get to banish this card from the graveyard to target a memento monster you control if it attacks a defense special monster and inflict piercing battle damage. Now, the issue with this is, like, it's not a quick effect. I would love it to be a quick effect like the banish. Not that it makes much of a difference because usually you'll be doing that anyway. But the reason of the benefit of this being a quick effect in the graveyard is you're allowed to do it during the battle phase. So the idea is you're going to give it to your Combined Creation, which is just going to do 5k piercing. Then for the trap cards, of course, we've got the one Fractured Dance and the one Cranium Burst, both of these very easily searchable in the deck. Then, of course, we do have three of the Field Spell. This one kind of gets you going and gets you ticking. So if a memento monster battles, your opponent cannot activate any spells or traps until the end of the damage step. And then if a monster or monsters you control is destroyed by battle or card effect, you get to target one of those monsters and special summon a memento monster with a lower level from the hand or graveyard. You can only use this effect once per turn. And then during your end phase, you get to target a memento spell or trap in your graveyard and reset it. So Cranium Burst or, of course, Fractured Dance. Because this card is so important, we are, of course, using Terraforming. We're also using Set Rotation, and the card we're going to give our opponent is the Gateway to Chaos. Now, the reason we're going to give our opponent the Gateway of Chaos is because this one is a mandatory effect that when this card is activated, you add a Blackluster Soldier, Ritual Monster, or Gaia the Fierce Knight. So back in the day, people were actually using this with Set Rotation to give it to your opponent. Because Set Rotation says neither player can activate field spells while either of the field spells set off of Set Rotation are still set. So the idea is your opponent cannot legally activate this card on the field, which means they can never actually put a new field spell into the field spell zone, which is really, really important because it completely locks them out. Of course, when you're looking into different formats as well with the Fire King matchups, being able to give this to your opponent not only replaces the Fire King Island to destroy their board, but also by giving them a card means you don't need to worry about Imperm from that point onwards, you don't need to worry about Evenly Matched, and you don't need to worry about Lightning Storm if they put a monster face up. Obviously, because it sets the card, they're able to activate Lightning Storm as they see fit, but sometimes giving your opponent a card can be quite detrimental to them. Then, of course, for the board breakers, these can be more hand traps if you want to go down that route. But I went with Double Triple Tactics Talents, Forbidden Droplet. And the reason that we're playing Forbidden Droplet as a preview is your options are either playing the hand trap in the form of Nibiru, or what I would prefer to do, which is what I'm doing in this particular build, play Triple Super Poly. Now, Super Poly is a great board breaker. Idea is if you go first, you're still able to set this and then use it as an interruption during your opponent's turn. If your opponent stops your plays at any point, again, you can set this in order to deal with their board. And the only thing that it really clashes with is your Tatsu, because the Tatsu is the one that wants you to special as long as you only control mementos. I would really like, actually, I'll tell you what we need, is we need a memento fusion monster, which I know we're getting twin-headed thunder dragon, I believe, in a memento form coming out later on, but I'd like to get some more, just so that we can kind of utilize Super Poly a lot more effectively, and just kind of make it like a memento monster plus a different attribute or just a monster on the field would be really cool. And then, of course, we've got two Pot of Prosperity, one Call by the Grave, and then the only hand trap I'm playing is Imperm. Now, I'm not saying this deck is designed for more OTK focused, but what I've tried to do with the selection of this is to kind of make it balanced. If I'm going first, great, set an Imperm, good hand trap. If I'm going second, Imperm, great hand trap. If I'm going first, set Super Poly, set Forbidden Droplet. If I'm going second, Forbidden Droplet, Super Poly, do everything I need to. The best thing about the combo with Super Poly and Forbidden Droplet is I can Super Poly my opponent's board apart, and if I've got a Tatsu, I can then Forbidden Droplet, send the Super Poly target, which could be a Garura, to give me a draw, as well as then being able to unlock my Tatsunoko plays as well. So it's trying to find that balance, which is why I'm arguing, contemplating putting Tatsu down to two. But it is such an incredibly important card for the deck, which is why it's kind of risky putting it at two as well. The extra deck is just complete flex space. You don't need to play any of these as mandatory. The only card that I feel is a really cool card to play around with in this deck is the Topologic Zeroboros. And the reason for that is it actually clears your board off, meaning that you'll then open up to use Tatsu again. Now, I know I'm talking about Tatsu quite a lot in this video. It's not a massive hindrance, but because it's a level 5, it kind of sticks in your hand a little bit more than you want it to if you do have other monsters on the board. So being able to utilize something like Topologic Zeroboros, especially when you have the ability to special during your opponent's turn, can be very, very effective. And then it gives you a massive boss monster to swing for game the next turn. Carrying on with the Link monsters, of course, we've got the Underworld Goddess, we've got Appaloosa, and then you're just playing staple cards in the form of SP, Dark, IP, Skytracker, Azalea. Now, the reason you'd go with this is you can only special summon it once per turn, but if it is special summoned, you get to target a card on the field and then destroy it. And then if you have three or less spells in the graveyard, otherwise you send it to the graveyard. You can play Donna if you want to, Domper. No, it is Donna. Donna Furhire, that lets you do a pop and a pop. But the reason I quite like this one is because it lets you target any card on the field, and then very rarely will you have the three spells, but if you do, you can keep it around. If you don't, you get rid of it. So it gives you the benefit of both. Cross Sheep for the Super Poly. When you Super Poly, it can bring back your mementos and you can start the chain off again. Relinquish Animar and Link Karibo can come off the back of your mace, as well as the Goblin as well, but very easily any of these can be the Donna as well. And then Typhoon, just to upgrade one of your monsters. Obviously, you don't want to be upgrading your big boss monster unless you've taken away its attack stats with the trap card to negate like Appaloosa. And if your Super Poly targets, Earth Golem, Garura, Mud Dragon, and Starving Venom. Obviously, you adapt these to the environment you're taking this deck to make them the most effective Super Poly targets you could possibly require. So don't go, these are the exact four that are going to be used in your deck, like they might be adapted depending on where you're going. You could very easily play Pot of Extravagance if you wanted to. It kind of has a little bit of a clash, but because I want to play the Super Poly route, you kind of want to control it, which is why we're playing Prosperity instead of Extrav. But the idea is get to as many of your mementos as possible. Yes, the issue is trying to protect the chain is very difficult because protecting the chain of everything they want to do, they want to be putting cards in the graveyard, which currently the anti-meta are trying to deal with because of the Fire Kings. Then they also want to be searching cards, which drawing Lockbird really hurts. Ashes, Imperms, Veilers, they literally run into every single hand trap in the game. And in this format, when everyone's running like 15 hand traps, it can be very, very devastating, which is why, like I said, in this particular version, I am deciding to main deck Droplets and Super Polys, so that if I do get stopped on my way up, it's not like, right, okay, I now have to rely on my hand traps. I actually have board-breaking cards that allow me to get more board presence or reduce my opponent's aggression so that they can't full-on OTK me the next turn, and I can negate their effects and stop them back just as successfully as they would do so for me. Anyway, that is it for the entire profile. Any questions, by all means, put them in the comments down below. I'll be more than happy to answer them for you. For now, as absolutely always, stay safe, and of course, happy dueling.